فاشرف بي لاشتغالي بالعلم ولا تبغي به ما عشت يا ذا بدلا ويا له من شرف عظيم.
الحمد لله رب العالمين له الحمد الحسن والثناء الجميل وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له يقول الحق وهو يهدي السبيل وأشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه والتابعين لهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين أما بعد. We're now inshallah ta'ala going to go into بعض الملامح في المذهب المالكي. We previously spoke about the most common or the most famous students of Imam Malik. We're now going to be speaking about some important issues related to the Madhab al-Malikiyyah. Okay? The Madhab of Imam Malik rahimahullah, it consists of, and it became known to gather the following information. Or the following is what the Madhab al-Malikiyyah is a component of. Okay? Al-Amru al-Awwal, the first thing is, the Madhab al-Malikiyyah, the first thing that it stands on is that ما كتبه الإمام مالك بنفسه, that which Imam Malik himself wrote. That which Imam Malik, he himself wrote. As we all know, Imam Malik rahimahullah, he wrote his Muwatta. He wrote his kitab, Al-Muwatta. And he placed inside it, فِقْحًا كَثِيرًا كَبِيرًا. He placed in it a lot of fiqh. And he placed inside it a lot of ilm, a lot of knowledge. With the Muwatta is also some essays, بعض الرسائل التي كتبها الإمام مالك, that Imam Malik himself wrote. I say some rasail, some small little books that Imam Malik rahimahullah wrote that are attributed to him. The Muwatta هو أصل كتب المذهب المالكي. It's the أصل, it's the backbone of the Madhab al-Malikiyyah. And if you read Kitab al-Muwatta and you open it and you look into it, you realize that it is a fiqh athar. It's a fiqh that's based upon textual evidence. It's a fiqh that is based upon al-hadithi wal-athar. قال رسول الله, the Prophet said, and statements from the Sahabas. That's the first thing that Madhab al-Malikiyyah consists of. The second thing is, ما سمعه تلاميذ الإمام مالك من مالك رحمه الله. The response and answers that the students of Imam Malik heard from their Shaykh Imam Malik. Imam Malik rahimahullah, he would be asked questions and he would respond to those questions. So some of his students would write those responses, and as Imam Malik, he wouldn't stop them from that. So the students of Imam Malik, they gave a lot of importance to that which is known as al-asma', which basically means ayma sumi'a an Malik ibn Anis, that which has been heard from Imam Malik. They used to give a lot of importance to that which was heard from Imam Malik. It was mentioned that Ibn al-Qasim, he was from those who are known as the Al-Asma'ah. And he wrote from Imam Malik, as I said to you, the word Asma'ah, what does it mean? Is ma sumi'a an Imam Malik. It's things that are heard from Imam Malik. Ibn al-Qasim was very well known in doing that. And he wrote from Imam Malik, and he had many of the Asma'ah from Imam Malik reached up to 300 jild. How much is that? It is equivalent to 300 volumes. 300 volumes of what? Answers and responses from Imam Malik. And we also mentioned last time, Ma'an ibn Isa. He was from the what? من الملازمين لإمام مالك. معن بن عيسى, we said, he's from the people who gave a lot of, he stayed with Imam Malik for a very long time. Or he stuck with Imam Malik. And he used to write every single thing that Malik would say. He would write it. Everything we mentioned now. The third is, the third thing that the Madhab al-Malikiyya consists of is ma yusamma bil mustakhrajat. That which you call al-mustakhrajat. You call it what? What do you call it? You call it al-mustakhrajat. What does al-mustakhrajat mean? Okay. Al-mustakhrajat is that which has been brought out ala fatwa al-imam. Meaning, this is the verdict and the answers that are given by an Imam Malik, but the students are going to extract some things from it. They're going to extract some things from it, the fatwa. They're going to get some fawaid and things out of it. And they're going to use it for something that Imam Malik wasn't talking about. And they try to apply it into that context. Are you with me? So Imam Malik gave a fatwa in a particular issue, and he gave an answer. A'immatul madhab, what they do is, they will go to the madhab, sorry, they will go to the fatwa of Imam Malik, and what will they do? They will take those fatwas, and they will place it on للمسائل التي لم ينقل عنها فيها فتوى, where there's no verdict regarding it. Now this is mustakharaj, this is something they extracted from it. Number four is اجتهادات أئمة المذهب كتلاميذ الإمام مالك. The fourth thing that the Madhab al-Maliki stands on is اجتهادات. اجتهادات means what? The independent reasoning of who? أئمة المذهب. The scholars of the Madhab al-Malikiyya. Okay? Their independent reasoning. Their striving. Such as the students of Imam Malik, for instance. So the Madhab al-Malikiyya, okay, it consists of those four that I just mentioned. The first one is Al-Muwatta, which is what Imam Malik wrote. And anything that also was written by Imam Malik. The second one is the Asmi'a, the verdicts that are heard from Imam Malik, questions he was asked and he answered them. The third was Al-Mustakhrajat, the A'immatul Madhab taking the fatawa of Imam Malik and placing it onto a place and a time which Malik rahimahullah did not give a fatwa regarding. And last but not least, Al-Ijtihadat, the independent reasoning of the A'immatul Madhab, the A'imma of the Madhab al-Malikiyya. This is the Madhab al-Malikiyya. When somebody says to you, I am a Maliki, his Madhab stands on these four. It's a component of these four. صح؟ أنا مالكي means these four are what my madhab stands on. That's the backbone of my madhab. Okay? And these four, it actually brought out great Islamic heritage for us. Through it, a lot of mashallah, masail ilmiya, knowledge base has come out from it. And the order is, as I mentioned, the order is in terms of authorship is Muwatta, thumma al-Asmi'a, and then the Mustakhrajat, and then the Mudawwanat A'immat al-Madhab. صح? That's the four. Now inshallah ta'ala I'm going to be speaking about أهم المؤلفات في المذهب المالكي. The most prominent, the most famous books that are written in the Madhab al-Malikiyya. Again, without a shadow of a doubt, what's the first book that is written in the Madhab al-Malikiyya? Al-Muwatta. So that's the first book. That's the first book that's written in this Madhab. The Imam himself wrote something. Then after that comes what is called Al-Mudawwana. Okay? Al-Mudawwana. Written by Sahnun, who died in 240 Hijriya. And the Mudawwana of Sahnun, are you there? Is originally as'ila, questions that were asked by Asad ibn al-Furat. Asad ibn al-Furat asked questions to Ibn al-Qasim. So the mudawwana of Sahnun is originally the questions that Asad ibn al-Furat put to Ibn al-Qasim. So when you look at the Madhab al-Malikiyah, what is the second asal for them? The first asal is what? The muwatta. The second asal is for them is what? Is the mudawwana of Ibn Sahnun. Now, the third kitab is Al-Mustakhrajah, written by Muhammad ibn Ahmad al-Utbi. It's also called Al-Utbiyyah. It's also called Al-Utbiyyah. It's Al-Mustakhrajah, written by Muhammad ibn Ahmad al-Utbi, who died the year 255, and some say no, he died 254, khilaf. And it is this kitab Ibn Rushd, who died the year 520 Hijriyah, it's this book which he worked on. And he called it Al-Bayan wa Tahsil. And the lengthy name is Al-Bayan wa Tahsil wa Sharh wa Tawjih wa Ta'lil Masail al-Mustakhraja. The fourth kitab is Al-Wadiha. And it's written by Abdul Malik ibn Habib al-Sulami. Al-Wadiha. And it's written by Abdul Malik ibn Habib al-Sulami, who died in year 238. And the fifth kitab is Al-Mawaziyah. Al-Mawaziyah. Written by Muhammad ibn Ibrahim, who's very well known as Al-Mawaz. That's his name. He died in year 269 Hijriah. His name is Muhammad ibn Ibrahim, who's very well known as Ibn al-Mawaz. Now, there's four books that I just mentioned to you that the Malikis would call it, they call it Al-Ummahat, the mothers. They call it the Ummahat. Okay? They call it Ummahatul Arba', the four mothers. The four mothers. I'm telling you in advance, the mustalah in the Malikiyya, when they say the four mothers, Al-Ummahatul Arba', in advance, you need to know what they mean by that. What do they mean? They mean the Mudawwana, written by Sahnun. They also mean the Utbiyya, written by Muhammad ibn Ahmad al-Utbi. Al-Mustakhraja. Okay? So the Utbiyyah and the Mustakhraja are the same. Okay? And the third one is Al-Wadiha, written by Abdul Malik ibn Habib al-Sulami. And the fourth one is Al-Mawaziyyah, which is written by Muhammad ibn Ibrahim, who's very well known as Ibn Mawaz. Are we all together? Those four books are called, according to the Malikis, what are they called? Al-Ummahat al-Arba', the four mothers. These four books that are the four mothers, Ibn Hajib, who died in 646. I think that brother's praying without no sutra. Over there, somebody plays sutra for him. Ibn Hajib, he died in 646 Hijriyah. He did, he's very well known as his Al-Mukhtasar. And his Al-Mukhtasar is what? Is Jami' al-Ummahat, which is known as Jami' al-Ummahat. What books did it gather? It's a summary, it's a khulasa, it's a mukhtasar, it's summarized. Of the what? The four books that I mentioned, which is the Al-Mudawwana, Al-Utbiyya, which is also known as Al-Mustakhraja, and Al-Wadiha, and Al-Mawaziyya. All those four books, Ibn Hajib, he gathered it in his Jami' al-Ummahat. Then came the famous Shaykh in the Madhab al-Maliki, none other than Khalil ibn Ishaq al-Misri, who died the year 776, who done a sharah, an explanation on Jami' al-Ummahat in his book At-Tawdih. He explained the book of Ibn Hajib, Jami' al-Ummahat, he explained it. Are you there? So he placed Khalil ibn Ishaq al-Misri, who died in the year 776 Hijriah. What he did was he explained the Jami' al-Ummahat in his book, which he called it At-Tawdih. And what he did was the sharah that he put on it, the sharah that he put on the Jami' al-Ummahat by Ibn Hajim, the sharah he put on it, he summarized his own sharah. And that's what you will hear from the Malikis say, Muqtasar Khalil. The Muqtasar of Khalil. That's their book. This is the book that Malikiyya have stood over. And they done, what do you call it? The Wafan. And the I'tikaf. And they spent their time and everything. They revolved around it. They worked on it. This kitab, when you look at it, the matter of Khalil, he wrote it like it's a riddle, like it's al-ghaz. When you read it, very hard for you to know what he's trying to say, because he's trying to summarize it as much as he could. He really did. He summarized. He's trying to summarize four books in a very small matter. He's trying to. So many of its places, when you come to, it's like Yamilu ila al-ghaz. He's like as though he's towards as though it's riddles. That you're reading a riddle. ولذلك you find many Malikiyya who memorize the matn of Khalil, who are memorizing it without any true understanding of it. بدون أن يكون عندهم في الحقيقة فقه, without any understanding of what they are reading. You find that. Why? Because of the author, the way he authored the book, and the way he placed the book. So his wordings, his ibarat, his terms, and the way he uses it, and the way he structures the words, are more closer to riddles than anything else. So what did the scholars do? Because it's a book written like that, they had to spend so much time doing fakhu al-ghazihi. Okay, explain what he means here. What's this riddle? How is he saying it like this? They place so much shuruh on it. They place so much explanation. And if you want to know the most famous matan Maliki, the most famous Maliki book, a matan, it's the matan of Khalil. The most famous one. Also, there's another famous one. In the Malikiyya, according to the Maliki, and it is what is known as Matnul Risala. And it's written by who? Ibn Abi Zayd al-Qayrawani. Are you there? And you know this kitab al-Risala, written by Ibn Abi Zayd al-Qayrawani, the Muqaddimah, he speaks about Aqidah. That's why it's called Muqaddimah Ibn Abi Zayd al-Qayrawani. And the scholars, they explain that book by itself, the Muqaddimah al-Risala. It's the introduction before he goes to the fiqh issues. He talks about aqidah and matters of aqaid. Are you with me? And this is to show you that the a'imma before, when they use the word fiqh, what do they mean by it? Fiqh for them was the whole religion, the whole deen. So Muqaddimah al-Risala by Ibn Abi Zayd al-Qayrawani is a muqaddimah, an introduction for this kitab al-Risala. Are you there? And Ibn Abi Zayd al-Qayrawani, he died the year 386, was the Imam in Aimatul Sunnah. His Aqidah Ahli Sunnah to Al-Jama'ah. لذلك, some people, they push that Malikiyya Asha'ira, وَهَذَا كَذِبُ الْأَفْتِرَاءِ. That's a lie. The biggest A'immatul Malikiyya of the Madhab are not Ibn Abdul Barr, Imam in Aimatul Sunnah. Ibn Abi Zayd al-Qayrawani, Imam in Aimatul Sunnah. Hadith wala haraj. There are many more you can name. But the first person who pushed the concept that it isn't is the, what's it called, Subki. Subki pushes that the a'immatul madahibs, those who follow the madhabs, are all asha'ira. He tries to push that concept. The scholars, they gave a lot of importance to the kitab al-Risala written by Ibn Abi Zayd al-Qayrawani. They placed on it, وَوَضَعُوا عَلَيْهَا شُرُوحًا كَثِيرًا. They placed many explanations on it. They did. Also from the mutul, from the books that are very famous in the Madhab al-Malikiyya, is the kitab known as Matn ibn Ashir, al-Andalusi, who died in 765 Hijriya. He called it al-Murshid al-Mu'in, ala al-Daruriyati min ulum al-Din. And this kitab has iddatu shuruh. Just know it as Matn ibn Ashir. Are you there, brothers? This kitab has many shuruhat, many hawashi, many explanations put on it. Also from the books that have that to shanin, that have great place in the Maliki madhab, is the Kitab al-Isti'ab li Aqwali Malik. Okay? The Kitab al-Isti'ab li Aqwali Malikin. And that is written by Ismail al-Qadi. His name is Abu Muhammad Abdullah ibn Hulayn ibn Abdullah al-Kilabi al-Qurtubi. He died here 318. What he found was, what did we mention before? That Ibn al-Qasim rahimahullah gathered from Imam Malik's question and answer. What did he gather from it? Al-Asmi'a, right? Many questions that he took from Malik, right? Ismail al-Qadi, what he found was that many of the books that have this Asmi'a, are you there? They don't only have the answers given by Malik. They actually have the answers of the students in there as well. It's not pure the statements of Malik only. So what he did was he wrote this book called Isti'ab li Aqwali Malik, where he wants to fully bring together just the statements of Imam Malik in these questions, in these answers. And to get rid of the statements of the Aqwalu Talamid, the statements of the students of Imam Malik. But he died qabla an yutimmahu, before he could actually finish it. He died before he could. Then two imams came after him and they tried to finish it off. ثُمَّ تَمَّهُ عَالِمَانِ مِنْ عُلَمَاءِ الْمَالِكِيَّةِ. Two imams from the A'immatul Maliki came and they finished it. The first one is Abu Bakr Muhammad ibn Ubaidullahi al-Mu'ayti. He finished it. And the second one is Abu Umar Ahmad ibn Abdullah al-Ishbili. So the al-Mu'ayti, he died in year 367. Whereas Abu Umar Ahmad ibn Abdul Malik al-Ishbili, who died in year 401 Hijriya. Also from the books that have that shanin, also from the books that have great weight in the Madhab al-Malikiyya, is Kitab al-Tafri', written by Ibn Jallab, who died in year 378. This kitab written by Ibn al-Jallab, which is called al-Tafri'. This kitab, it is min al-kutub bi dhati shan, it's from the great books within the Madhab al-Malikiyya. It has powerful status. Also, the books that are given consideration in the Madhab al-Malikiyya is al-Tahdhib fi ikhtisar al-Mudawwana. This kitab is called al-Tahdhib fi ikhtisar al-Mudawwana, and it's written by Abu Sa'id Khalaf ibn Abi al-Qasim al-Azdi al-Qayrawani, who is known as Al-Baradi'i. He died in year 372 Hijriya. Some of the A'immatul Malikiyya actually criticized Al-Baradi'i. They criticized him. And they criticized him for taking the word Mudawwana. Okay, Al-Mudawwana. Taking the word Mudawwana and using it in other than what it really is meant to be used. Okay? So they accused him of changing the intents that are in the mudawwana fi ba'd al-mawadi'. Fi ba'd al-mawatin. Also from the books that are important in the Madhab al-Malikiyya is the Kitab al-Talqin. Kitab al-Talqin. And it's written by Qadi Abdul Wahab. And also the Kitab al-Irshad, written by AbdulRahman ibn Muhammad al-Baghdadi. Al-Qadi Abdul Wahab, he died in the year 422 Hijriya, and Al-Irshad is written by AbdulRahman ibn Muhammad al-Baghdadi. He died in the year 732 Hijriya. Now I'm going to move on to Istilahat al-Malikiyyati fi kutubihim. The Malikis, what terms they use in their books. In their books, they use terms. Okay? What are the terms that they use in their books? The first one is Al-Kitab. When the Malikiyya say Al-Kitab, the book. So إطلاق لفظ الكتاب. I mean, إذا أطلق لفظ الكتاب. If the word Al-Kitab is unrestrictedly said like that, فإنهم يريدون به المدونة. They mean by it the مدونة. Okay? Why? لعلو الشأن هذا الكتاب في فقه المالكي. Because it has a very big place in the Maliki madhab. That's why they call it Al-Kitab. The مدونة. Who wrote it? Did I mention the right Mudawwana? Yeah? Yeah? Huh? Huh. So the Mudawwana for them is a big book. So they refer to it as the book. Like there's no other book as though it's the only book. They say the book. The next book that they use, Al-Ummahat Al-Arba'a, the four mothers. Which books do they refer to as the four books, Saad? The four mothers. The Mudawwana, hey, and the Mustakhraja, and the Al-Mawaziyya. What other name is the Mustakhraja known as? Al-Utubiyya. So when they say Al-Ummahat Al-Arba', they mean these four books. When they say Al-Dawaween, كما في الدواويني, the word Al-Dawaween, as it's written in the Dawaween. Dawaween. When they say Al-Dawaween, what do they mean by Al-Dawaween? When they say that, they mean by, so many times you see them use كما في الدواوين, as it's in the Dawaween. They mean by it seven books. The first four are what? The Ummahatul Arba' that we just mentioned. Al-Mudawwana wal-Mustakhraja, also known as Al-Utbiyya, and Al-Mawaziyya and Al-Wadiha, right? Those are the four mothers. And then they add on to it the Mukhtalita, written by Ibn al-Qasim, and the Mabsuta, written by Qadi Ismail, and the Majmu'a, written by Ibn al-Ubdus. Ibn al-Ubdus. So the first one is the Mukhtalita, written by who? Ibn al-Qasim. Al-Mukhtalata, written by who? Al-Mukhtalata, written by Ibn al-Qasim. Or the Mabsuta, written by who? Qadi Ismail, Hudaniyya 282 Hijriya. Al-Majmu'a, written by Ibn al-Ubdus, Hudaniyya 260 or 261. Those seven, the previously mentioned four, okay, and the three additional added, are you there? Are you with me? But what seems to be apparent, wallahu a'lam, is that the Mukhtalita written by Ibn al-Qasim is actually the Mudawwana. It does seem that way. But they refer to it as Dawawin al-Sab'ah, even though it's only six books. Good. Also, istilahat which are khassa. So we mentioned terms that are specific in their books. Now we're going to speak about terms that are specific for their scholars and their shuyukh. When they say al-madaniyun, Al-Madaniyun. Does anyone have a tissue? Just wait. The sisters most likely would have it. Whoa, that looks scary. You didn't use it, huh? BarakAllahu feek, Aswad. So when they say Al-Madaniyun, when they say Al-Madaniyun, وعند المدنيين, what do they mean by the word مدنيين, أما مدنيون? They mean من أتباع الإمام مالك, the followers of الإمام مالك. And they specifically Ibn Kinana, who died in 186 Hijriya. Ibn Kinana, Ibn al-Majishun, who died in 212 Hijriya. Mutarrif, who died in 220. Mutarrif, who died in 220. Ibn Nafi', Ibn Nafi', who died in 206. Okay. And Ibn Maslama, who died in 216. وَنَظَائِرُهُ مِنَ الْمَدَنِيِّينَ, and the likes of them who were from Medina. So who are they? Ibn Kinana, who died in 186, the first one. The second one is who? Ibn al-Majishun, who died in 212. Mutarrif, who died in 220. Ibn Nafi' who died year 206. Ibn Maslama who died year 216. And the likes of these. When they say Wal Masriyun, the Egyptians. The Madaniyun means those people from Medina. What about when they say Egyptians? They're referring to five, and the likes of these five. Ibn al-Qasim, Ashhab, Ibn Wahb, Asbagh, Ibn Abd al-Hakam. So Ibn al-Qasim, who's from Egypt, Ashhab, who's from Egypt, Ibn Wahb, who's from Egypt, Asbagh, who's from Egypt, and Ibn Abd al-Hakam, who's from Egypt, wa nudara'ihim, and anyone like them. That's what they mean. Wal-Iraqiyun, when they say Iraqis. The Iraqis. They mean Al-Qadi Ismail ibn Ishaq. And also Al-Qadi Abil Hassan ibn Qassar. Ibn Qassar, he died in the year 398. Ibn Jallab. Al-Qadi Abdul Wahab. Al-Qadi Abil Faraj al-Baghdadi, who died in 331 Hijriya. And also, al-Shaykh Abu Bakr al-Abhari, who died in 365 Hijriya. وَنُّذَرَائِهِمْ and anyone like them. So these are the ones they refer to when they say al-Iraqiyun. Then they come to the al-Maghariba, those who they say are from Morocco. Not just Morocco, but Tunisia, Algeria, all of that is known as Maghrib. The Maghariba is referred to by as Ibn Abi Zayd al-Qayrawani. Are you with me? And also Ibn al-Qabisi and Ibn al-Labbad. Ibn al-Qabisi died in 403 and Ibn al-Labbad he died in 333. Abu Walid al-Baji who died in 474. And also the likes of them, such as Ibn Abdul Barr, who died in 463, and also Ibn Rushd, who died in 520. All of these are known as the ulama al Maghariba. They are Immatul Malikis, but they are in Maghrib. Alhamdulillah. وقال الأخوان وعند الأخوين when they say أخوان or أخوين are you there? The word أخوان or أخوين they refer to is Mutarrif and Ibn Majishun. Are you there? When they say with the two brothers they're referring to who? Mutarrif and Ibn Majishun. Why is Mutarrif and Ibn Majishun both referred to as brothers, the two brothers? The reason why innahuma summiya bidhalika likathrati ma yattafiqani alayhi min al-ahkam, as Hashiyat al-Adawi mentions, that they two used to agree with each other a lot in matters of ahkam. So they became brothers like that. They would agree with each other a lot in matters of ahkam. Al-Qadiyani, the two qadis, and they refer to here as the two qadis that we just mentioned before. One is Al-Qadi Ibn Qassar, صح? Al-Qadi Abil Hassan Ibn Qassar, who is from the ulama of Iraq in Morocco. And the next one is Al-Qadi Abdul Wahhab, who is also from the ulama of Iraq. They are both called the two qadis. Al-Muhammadani, the two Muhammads. When they say two Muhammads, who do they mean? They mean Ibn al-Mawaz and Ibn Sahnun. وعند ابن عرفة. And this is Ibn al-Mawaz and Ibn Sahnun. According to Ibn Arafah, who died in 803, to him, the Muhammadani is not Ibn Mawaz and Ibn Suhunur. It's actually Ibn Mawaz and Ibn Abd al-Hakam. It's actually those two, and not Ibn Suhunur. Ibn Suhunur is not it. What about al-Muhammaduna, the Muhammads? Hum arba'atun, they are four. And they all were at the same era. All four of these were at the same era. They lived fi asrin wahid. And there are four a'immatul malikiyah, but all of them started with Muhammad. The first one is Ibn Abdus, and Ibn Suhunun, and Ibn Abd al-Hakam, and Ibn Mawaz. All four of those are known as what? Al-Muhammaduna, the Muhammads. When they say Al-Imam, the Imam, Malikiyah, when they unrestrictedly use the word Al-Imam, they mean by that Al-Maziri, who died in 536. Al-Maziri, to them, is the Imam. When they say Al-Shaykh, the Shaykh, when they say Al-Shaykh, the Shaykh, who are they referring to? Ibn Abi Zayd al-Qayrawani, the author of the Risala. So when they use the word Al-Shaykh, they mean Ibn Abi Zayd al-Qayrawani. When they say As-Saqaliyani, they mean by Ibn Yunus and Abd al-Haq. As-Saqaliyya, yani is who? Ibn Yunus and Abd al-Haq. Abd al-Haq, he died in the year 466. When they say Al-Shaykhani, the two sheikhs, when they say the two sheikhs, Al-Shaykhani, the two sheikhs, they mean by it Ibn Abi Zayd al-Qayrawani and Abu al-Hassan al-Qabisi. Now we're going to go into the istilahat which they use when it comes to narration and statements. If they say ar-riwayat, narrations. When they say ar-riwayat, narrations, they don't mean the narrations of the Prophet that's come from him. They mean aqwal al-Imam Malik, the statements of al-Imam Malik. If they say al-aqwal, if they say aqwal, okay, just a second, they also mean majority of the times the statements of who? Al-Imam Malik. If they mention there's an ittifaq in this issue, there's an agreement on this issue, then they mean ittifaqu ahli al-madhhab, the agreement of the scholars of the madhhab. And this, brothers, this matter, wallahi, it requires and it needs from us at-tanabbuh lahu. We have to really understand this issue now, which is, some people read in the books of fiqh, they read mas'ala, there's an ittifaq in this issue. And they will come out to you later and they will say to you, وَعَلَى هَذَا وَقَعَ عَلِي اتِّفَاق. This matter, there has come regarding it an ittifaq, an agreement. So he would think to himself, there's an ijma' in this issue. And it, many books of madhabs, when they use the word ittifaq, they don't mean outside their madhab. Because the only thing that they take into consideration is what? Their only madhab. So when they transmit ittifaq from books of madhabs, a lot of the times you need to verify, what do they mean by it? Because a lot of the times they mean by it, ittifaq ahlul madhab. The people of this madhab have agreed on this particular issue. Also, ijma'. And the word ijma', of course, they mean by ijma'ul ulama. Of course, they mean the consensus of the ulama. If they say al-jumhur, if they say in their books, the jumhur believe this, the majority believe this, to them the jumhur is what? Al-a'immatul arba'ah, the four a'immatul madhab. That's what they mean. Also, in the books of the Madhab al-Malikiyah, you find many of the times they will mention وَعِنْدَ الْمُتَقَدِّمِينَ, the early scholars have said this, and وَعِنْدَ الْمُتَأَخِرِينَ, and the latecomers, they said this. So who do they mean by the mutaqaddimin, and then who do they mean by the mutaakhirin? Who is the mutaqaddim to them and who is mutaakhir to them? To them, the mutaqaddimun, the early ones, is anyone before al-Shaykh Ibn Abi Zayd al-Qayrawani. Anyone before Ibn Abi Zayd al-Qayrawani is known as the mutaqaddim, is the early one. Okay? And the mutaakhir, as it seems apparent, is anyone فيما بعد الشيخ ابن أبي زيد القيرواني. It's anyone who comes after ابن أبي زيد القيرواني. ولذلك if you look at حاشية السوقي على شرح الكبير, he mentions that ابن أبي زيد القيرواني is what? He is what? He is خاتمة المتقدمين. He is the seal of the متقدمين. And he is what? أول المتأخرين. He is the last of the متقدمين and he is the first of the متأخرين. صح? He is the last of the early generation and he is the first of what? The late generation. Are you with me? So they distinguish any statement that comes before Ibn Abi Zayd al-Qayrawani as من المتقدمين and anything that comes after it as the متأخرين. So he is the حد الفاصل. He is the distinguishing factor between what statement came from the mutaqaddimin and what statement came from the mutaakhirin. If they say now we're going to move on to inshallah ta'ala istilahat al-malikiyya fi tarjih. We're going to move on to the statements that the malikiyya would do if they want to strengthen one view over another. How would they, the terms that they would use. Okay. For example, if they say al-adhhar, or mashhur, or sahih, or al-asah, these are the terminologies that they would use. For example, the word al-adhhar. Let's take the first one. Al-adhhar. Are you with me? What the word al-adhhar means to them is that there is another view out there, which is apparent, but this is more apparent. The second one is al-mashhur. They would use the word al-mashhur. Mashhur means to them the opposite of ma yuqabiluhu al-ghareeb. It's any view that's not that's strange in the madhab al-malikiyah. So for example, if they say al-mashhur, they mean what is famous and commonly known in the madhab. Anything that's said that's ghareeb, that's strange, for them they won't refer to that as mashhur. Within them, they didn't agree on the word mashhur, what it means. But that's just one view. Another view pushes and says that the word mashhur is ma qawiya daliluhu. Any matter which the evidence is strong is called mashhur. Any issue which the evidence that's been used for it is actually strong is called mashhur. Are you there? Others have said, no. Mashhur actually just means ma kathura qailuhu. The ones who are saying it are a lot in number. Ma kathura qailuhu. Those who are saying it are a lot in number. It doesn't matter whether it's got strong evidence or not. And it doesn't matter whether there's a strange opinion regarding it. It doesn't matter. It's just the fact that the number we look at. So these are all what they mean by the word mashhur. Then they have the word as-sahih. Sahih means what? That which is clear. Or in other words, that which is authentic. And the opposite is what? Al-da'if, that which is weak. Okay. Al-asahu means, so the opposite. So when they say there's a sahih, what's the opposite to it? Any view other than it is what? Da'if. You there? But what about if they say al-asahu? This is the strongest opinion. The other opinion out there is what? It's sahih. Yuqabiluhu sahih. When the word al-asahu is used, you always need to know, because it's sigatul mubalagha ala wazni af'ul. Are you there? The opposite to it is what? The opposite to it is sahih. It's that which is authentic. So the other views are authentic views, but this is more authentic. This is some of the mustalahat which are present in al-mawjuda fi kutub al-malikiyya. As for the mutun, the small mutun books of the madhhab al-malikiyya, they have their own terms that you need to look at. Okay? Are you there, brothers? The mutuns, I just gave you a terms that are used generally within the Maliki books, especially in their works that are mutawwalat, those books which are, you know, detailed books. But in the mutun, the small books like Matnu al-Khalil and the likes of these books, these little mutun, they have sometimes mustalahat, terminologies which are khas, specific to them. They might use their own, they might make their own terms and use it. So what it would need from a person, a student of knowledge, is every method that you're taking is for you to study the methodology of the author of that book. And how has he chosen to summarize the madhab in this book? Okay, it's important. وَلِذَلِكَ since we're going to be going through Matn Abi Shuja'a, we're going to see a lot of that happen. So we're going to have to explain terms that the author uses, the manhaj of the mu'allif, and etc. inshaAllah ta'ala. Today we finished Madhab al-Malikiyyah. I've concluded it, inshaAllah ta'ala. And since we've stopped there and we've concluded there, and I will also conclude, inshaAllah ta'ala, there. Next week we will speak about Al-Madhab al-Shafi'i. And that is the one we're going to spend a bit of more time in. And the reason why we're going to is, we're studying Madhab al-Shafi'i. Okay? We're studying that, the Madhab al-Shafi'i. And the book we're going to be doing is what? Matn Abi Shuja'. So we need to have more understanding of this madhab than anything else. So we're going to spend a lot of time in the madhab and matters pertaining to it, inshaAllah ta'ala. Anything which I have said that was wrong or incorrect is from me and shaytan, and Allah and His Messenger are free from it. Subhanakallahumma bihamdik. Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah. Astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk.